Hello, Tech World. This is Tech Thoughts. Welcome to this special Tech Thoughts video series focused on learning PowerShell. This is an operationally designed video series. This is the first video in the series, the three commands that you'll need to learn to start using PowerShell. The corresponding article for this topic can be found in the techthoughts.info blog, which I've linked in the description below. Let's go ahead and get started. I encourage you to follow along. It's one of the best ways to learn. And in order to do that, you are going to need PowerShell. If you're on a Windows device that ships natively as part of the operating system, you can come over to your start menu, type in PowerShell, and get a console session launched relatively quickly. If you're on a Mac OS or if you are using Linux, there's a couple more steps that you'll need to take, but it's a very simple download and very simple install process. And I've linked in the description below to get you started on that process. But once you have it installed, it's very easy to launch the terminal window. You'll have PowerShell up and running in no time. So before we dive into the three commands that you need to learn to start using PowerShell, I want to take a moment to go over just some of the basics. And the first thing is that PowerShell commands are referred to as cmdlets. We can go ahead and run one right now. And that'll be git time zone. So if we click enter, you'll notice that this returns an object because PowerShell does deal with objects. And this particular object contains data about the time zone configuration of this particular device. So if you followed along, congrats, you just ran your first cmdlet. The other thing about cmdlets is they follow a certain structure. PowerShell is designed to be very easy and accessible. It's designed to make our jobs easier. And it follows a verb noun structure, which makes it a little bit easier to learn. So if we look at this git, that's our verb, that's the action that's being done. And then our noun is time zone. That's the thing that's going to be acting against. And so we can infer a couple things because of this verb noun relationship. The first is that because it's using git, we can kind of infer this is a read-only action and isn't going to change anything on our device if we run a git command. We can also infer, based on the git, that there might be a more actionable verb like set. So we might check to see if there is a set time zone, and in fact there is. So even if you don't have all of the commands memorized, which is not very likely, you can infer, based on the verb-noun relationship, what available cmdlets there might be to you. So again, PowerShell is designed to be extremely accessible. It's designed to make you faster, quicker, more accurate. And to that end, there's really only three commands that you need to understand to start using it pretty effectively. And the first one is git command. This is one you'll just have to memorize. And git command, based on the verb noun that we learned just a moment ago, we can infer this is going to get some commands. And if we use a common programming tactic of using an asterisk, which acts as a wildcard, what's going to happen right now is this will get every single cmdlet that's available on this particular device. So if we click enter, you'll notice that this will return every single command that this device is capable of running currently. So that could be pretty interesting to explore as you find out what commands are possible, but most of the time you'll be focused on trying to accomplish a certain task. So let's try to see if we were focused on, say, processes. Does this box have the ability to run commands related to processes? So we'll use our wildcards again and wrap process inside of those two wildcards. So again, this cmdlet, verb noun, is going to be acting against this particular wildcard name and seeing if there's any cmdlets that contain this word, process. And we'll go ahead and click enter. We can see pretty unsurprisingly that we do have a couple of cmdlets that are capable of doing things with processes on our system. We have git process, we have start process, stop process, and of course all of these adhere to that verb-noun relationship that we discussed a moment ago. As someone new to PowerShell, you may be thinking to yourself, well, that's great, but I don't have a lot of confidence that start process does what I think it does. The verb-noun is nice, but maybe I'm wrong and I don't want to break something. Well, that's where the second command comes in, and that's git help. So before we get started running git help, it's a good idea to run update help to make sure you have all the latest help files. In order to do that, you will need to launch PowerShell as an administrator. Now, on a Windows device, you would need to find your launch console and then run as administrator. That's how you would launch a PowerShell window as admin inside of Windows. And then you can simply run update help. And that will go out and fetch all of the help files for all of your commands, making sure that you have the latest help that's the most accurate. Now, unfortunately, on the Linux side of things, update help isn't today working quite as intended. And so you'll need to do things a little differently. You can see here that if we attempt to run update help, that there is a known bug on a couple of the Linux distros where the read-only file system error pops. This is a known issue and the PowerShell team is working to fix it, but I'll show you a workaround if you're running PowerShell on Linux today. So that's going down and getting all of our update help files, and we'll give that just a moment to finish. Okay, with update help complete, what we can do now is verify if our theory is correct. Does stop process do what we think it's going to do? So we simply can type in git-help, the second command that you're going to need to memorize, and then follow that with stop process. And if we click enter, what you'll see here is a synopsis of what stop process does. It stops one or more running processes, and a more in-depth description about what you can expect this commandlet to do. So you are welcome to read through that. I wanted to draw your attention to the bottom though, where the remarks will highlight that the fact that you can run git help stop process dash examples. So this examples is a parameter, and that's specifying the git help to take an additional action on that commandlet. So we'll do git help stop process again, and this time adding the examples parameter. So when we run that, we'll get several examples that are provided back from that result. So we'll see example of stop process name notepad. So this is how you would go ahead and stop a notepad. And again, because this is a action verb of stop, we can infer this is gonna take an action against our machine, whereas git is read only. So armed with those two commandlets, git command and git help, you can basically teach yourself every single command that's on the box. Linux users, you have the option of git help. We can still do stop process. And you have the online parameter. And what this will do is instead of pulling it into the actual console window, it will launch a website that actually contains all of the help information. This is no different than the information that's inside of the console return, except that because of that bug, you'll need to look it up on the actual website. All right, so now we know how to find commands and how to evaluate if they do what we think. The last command is git member. Git member is the more complicated of the three. So as discussed previously, PowerShell deals with objects. We saw a moment ago that git time zone returned an object. But what type of object was that? Well, we can use git member to evaluate what type of object we're dealing with. So if I run git date, this appears to return some type of string that says it's Wednesday, June 19th, 2019. But is it in fact a string? Well, let's evaluate that with git member. So we'll do git date and we will do git member. Don't worry too much about what this is right now. We'll get to this in great detail in a later lesson. Make sure to hit that subscribe button to learn more about what we're doing with this pipeline. So we will pipe git date to git member. And if we click enter, we get a lot of stuff returned, but I'm gonna teach you a little bit about how to evaluate the results of this. So the first thing is that git date is returning a system.datetime object. This is the type of object that is returned to us. Now there's lots of methods that we can do against that object, but for the purpose of this lesson, I want to draw your attention to the properties of this object. Note that this object, the date time object, has many different properties. It has day, day, day of week, day of year, hour, kind, millisecond. So this is a very complex data object that contains a lot of information about the date. Now, some commandlets, like git date, only return the information that PowerShell thinks that you're most likely going to want, which is, you know, a very nicely displayed git date. Now, if we pipe that to a format list, and again, stay tuned for future videos as we discuss that more in depth, you'll notice that we do indeed get back all of these properties. Those same properties were available in this object as well. It was just structured a little bit differently because PowerShell thinks that's probably what we want. But that data is still available in all of the object returns. You just need to go retrieve it. And you'll note that git member did indeed advise us correctly, and all of those properties are present in that git date object return. Now let's take a look at a more simple object like git random. Git random is a commandlet that will return some random number. If you're not sure, we can always git help git random. As I stated, it gets a random number. But what type of object does it return? So we'll do git random and pipe that to git member. And you'll notice that this will return a system int 32. So this is not a complex object. Notice that it has several methods, but no additional properties. This is a very simple object. It is simply an integer 32 number type. So working with objects in PowerShell is very important, and it's important to understand what type of object that you're working with, and GitMember can help you do that. So those are the three commandlets that, if you know, you can pretty much evaluate everything that you need to do in PowerShell. Git command, git help, and git member. One thing to watch out for is that git command sometimes will not always find exactly what you're looking for. For example, if we want to do something with a file and maybe evaluate it and find out some information about a file, you might infer that something along the lines of file might be the appropriate way to go with that. And as you evaluate some of these, you may find that some of them don't necessarily give you exactly what you want. There is not, for example, a git file commandlet. So sometimes, even armed with git command, you won't be able to find necessarily the exact command that you're looking for. That's not a big deal. Simply come back to Google and fire up a quick search and say something like PowerShell git file information. You know, that'll very quickly lead you to the correct commandlet. And if you're not sure what that commandlet does, you can, of course, copy that and run a git help against git item property and find out exactly what it does. Gets the properties of a specified item. So we can also see some examples to see if it is doing exactly what we think. And we can see here that it is being run against certain file types. And so this looks to be like what we're looking for. So you can safely run this because we understand verb noun, and this is going to be read only against a file. It's not going to make any changes. Okay, so I will leave you with a bonus commandlet. PowerShell can't do everything, right? Or can it? So for example, native PowerShell is unable to send Telegram messages. It just can't. However, PowerShell does have the ability to install modules, and those modules can provide a lot more power to PowerShell. So our final bonus commandlet is find module. And if we provide it the parameter tag, we can look up something like Telegram and see if there's a module out there on the PowerShell gallery that is capable of adding Telegram capabilities to PowerShell. If you can think of it, most likely someone out there has written the capability. So find module is a fantastic commandlet to know. So you may be thinking, if I do find a module that has the capability I want, how do I get it installed? Well, now that you understand how to use git command, git help, and git member, you have all the tools necessary to figure out how to get that module installed yourself. Hint, there's probably a commandlet for that. Don't forget that all of this information is available in written format on the techthoughts.info blog. And if you found this video helpful, go ahead and click that like button and subscribe for more Tech Thoughts videos.